So, Jesus' immediate family, his extended family, is very upset with him, very worried about him. Here he is attracting so many people coming, looking for curing, looking for release from demonic possession, looking to find some sort of meaning and purpose in their lives. And his extended family is surprised at all of this. One wonders why. Perhaps Mary never really told them much about all the things that happened at his birth, all about magi and shepherds and angels flying about. St. John in his Gospel does say that she kept all these things in her heart and pondered on them. So it seems that his family had no sense of who he really was, and were very worried for him. But at least they were worried for him, less than for themselves, because the religious leaders were in a very different place. They understood what he was doing. They could see the people who were being cured. They could see the people who were being released from the power of evil, but they found that far too threatening for them. It was undercutting their authority. It was undercutting their power, and they hated him for that. And so they said not what his family was saying. He's wacko, he's crazy. They were saying, no, he's possessed by Beelzebul himself. He's possessed by the very power of evil. Because their interest was not in him and his needs. Their interest was in themselves and their own power. We see something similar to that, I think, in the Genesis reading today. The section right before the one that we read today, where the temptation first happens, you may remember that what the tempter, what the serpent, says to Eve is, the reason you really want this fruit is that this will make you like God. And God doesn't want that, because God is jealous of you. Eve, what you really want is to get the power and the glory and the wonder by taking this fruit. And she falls for it. And she gives it to Adam, and he falls for it. But then, did you notice in the section that we read today, then they're all blaming one another. No one of them is willing to take responsibility for it. Adam basically throws Eve under the bus. He says, look, I only took it because the woman gave it to me. Not only that, but did you notice he blames God? He says, the woman you gave me gave this fruit to me. So God, it's really your fault. Don't blame me. It's your fault, and it's hers. And then when God turns to Eve and asks for an explanation, she blames the serpent who tricked her. But there again, the issue is, what about me? How do I get myself off the hook? How do I keep myself from being blamed for this, even if it means blaming someone whom I supposedly love, whom I'm supposedly connected with? That's all right. I can blame them as long as I get myself away from it. Once again, it's a question of, it's all about me, not about my relationship with others. So I think in both of those senses, both of those scriptures, the way in which the evil one gets power over us is by getting us to think only what's in it for me. And the evil one loses power over us when we are able to think, what is it for others? That's very easy to say, I realize, and not all that easy to do. We're all surrounded by a society that tells us it's all about me. And yet, we hear Paul in the lesson today say to us, yes, in one way it is about you. It is about the love that God has for you. But that love is given to you to empower you, Paul says to us, than to be able to love others. The grace of God is given to us, Paul says, to empower us to work with the Spirit bringing about the new world and bringing about the kingdom of God. So as we gather at the Lord's table today, as we receive once again this incredible intimacy with Jesus in his own body and blood, we thank him for what he has done for us. But then in that, we ask for the continued gift of his Spirit so that we can take that love, that gift, that will then make of us people of greater love, greater compassion for others, as we indeed work with him to renew the face of the earth.